And welcome to another Down the Rabbit Hole video. I'm doing another video response to Ben over at TRex Spacestation. He's asked another 5 questions about random games in our collections with different themes. And I thought I'd do yet another response to this because I quite like this. I like telling little stories about the different games in my collection. So let's get on with it. The first question that he asked is, name a game with a beautiful art style. Now, I'm going to slightly cheat here. I'm not choosing one with a beautiful art style. I'm choosing one with an art style that is very distinctive and very important to the game itself. And that is Mad World on the Wii. This is actually one of the rare M-rated games that came out for the Wii, and it's a slashing game. You go through this like nasty world with a chainsaw, and you kill guys, and there's zombies and stuff like that. And the designers, I guess to deal with the limitations of the Wii, what they decided to do was to make the entire world black and white. Like, you are exactly like this. This is severe noir black art style, or black and white, black pencil art style. Everywhere you go is black and white. You are entirely black and white. The whole game is black and white. It looks very distinctive. It really works well for the tone because it's nasty and very much it earns its M rating. The only color you ever see is red for the blood that gushes out of your enemies, and occasionally yellow to bring your attention to something. But yeah, a really, really great use of art to make a game work on, you know, what is admittedly rather limited hardware. It can be a little jarring on the eyes after a while. Like, it takes some not quite Virtual Boy territory, but it's the kind of game you only want to play in short bursts. But a really good game, and it definitely uses its art in a very important and significant way. So I'm going to say Mad World on the Wii is my game with distinctive art style. The second game Ben asked about is name a handheld game. Now, I'm sure a lot of people are going to be selecting Game Boy titles or stuff. Somebody did one on the PSP or perhaps Sega Game Gear. What I'm going to do is actually kick it a little older school than that, and I'm going to talk about an actual handheld game. I'm going with the one from the 1970s, Digital Derby. And I know there's going to be a lot of UK watchers who are going to say, even though it's spelt D-E-R-B-Y, it's actually pronounced Darby. That is true. I admit that I know that, and I continue to call it Digital Derby, because here in North America, that's just what it's always been referred to as, because we don't know any better. But anyway, so yes, I know it should be Digital Darby. I'm going to call it Digital Derby just out of, out of old habit. Now, this is a really neat little handheld, and I've actually done a video about this already, but it's a little driving game. You turn your wheel, and this little car moves back and forth, and the road travels with other cars you have to dodge around. And it was one of the very first games that I saw that I thought, like, as a kid of 8 or 9 years old, I just thought, that is really cool. That's like the kind of thing we have in the amusement parks here of, like, little coin-operated, you know, carpets with cars on it, and the carpet rolls towards you, and you have to dodge around. Like, I had seen those a lot in the amusement park, and when I saw this advertised on television, I thought, you can have one of those at home, that's so cool, but it was way beyond what I could afford. It chews batteries like there's nobody's business. I mean, there's a lot of turning gears inside here, and yeah, it'll use up the rather expensive batteries that have to go in it all the time, so this was never going to happen for me as a kid. Many years later, I got this one, and I really, really like it, and it's sort of a childhood ambition, or a holy grail, if you will, that came true. So I really like Digital Derby, and that is my handheld game of choice. The next game that Ben asked about is name a game with airplanes in it. And I could have gone with Afterburner on the 32X, because I've already done a video about that. I think a lot of people are probably going to select Afterburner. So I thought, let's go with something probably nobody has chosen. And this is a fairly recent one. This is Birds of Steel on the PlayStation 3. I got this because a friend of mine and I are really into flying games, and World War II is a great setting. We got IL-2 Sturmovik, which we really loved. I mean, that is a very good game for your PlayStation 3. And we both got joysticks and throttles and all that kind of stuff. But we found a problem with IL-2 was we couldn't find a way, maybe it exists, we could never figure out how to add like AI, some bots to fly against in the skies over Europe. So what we ended up doing is just flying around in circles trying to shoot each other. And we thought, yeah, this isn't very fun. Then Birds of Steel was announced, and there were two things that I really liked about it. Number one, yes, you can add bots. Perfect. Number two, and this is something that I don't know if a lot of people know this. They certainly didn't advertise it very well. If you have a USB keyboard, you can plug it into the front of your PS3, and you can actually map all of those other controls that flight sim people like to have mapped to things. You can map it to keyboard strokes. So your brakes, your ailerons, maybe not your ailerons, but you know, your flaps, your all those things that you need to do, your landing gear, you can actually assign a button to that. And what's great is, because that's always a problem, anytime you're trying to do a really detailed flying game on a console, you've only got, 17 buttons on your typical PlayStation controller? How are you going to map everything that an airplane needs into that? With this game, you plug in a USB keyboard to the front of your PS3, you can map whatever you want on any of those keys, and it'll work. So I actually asked at work, I was like, hey, you guys got some USB keyboards you're throwing away, right? Yeah. Can I have one? Sure. And now, I couldn't find it for this video, but I actually got one that's got little labels all over the keys of, like, brakes, flaps, landing gear, etc., etc. Bomb cargo bay. That's a really good feature that this thing has. So if you really like your flying games and you've got a PS3, and it does support, you know, your typical HOTAS Thrustmaster joystick, the combination is stellar. This looks amazing. It's a really good game. Highly recommend it. Birds of Steel is my game with airplanes in it. For the fourth question, Ben was asking to name a platformer game. Now, there's a lot of these, and I'm sure a lot of people are going to choose the well-known ones like Mario and Crash Bandicoot and I guess Sonic counts? Yeah. So I thought, well, I'm going to go with something that has that same nostalgic resonance for me, but it's a bit of an older type of a title, kind of. I really loved, when I was a kid, going to the arcade, I saw Dragon's Lair for the first time, and I thought, ooh, that looks really good, and okay, it was 50 cents, whereas most games were 25, but I thought, it's worth it, I liked it, and then many years later, I think it was 2002, they actually released Dragon's Lair on DVD, and not only has it got some documentaries and stuff, you can play the game with your DVD remote, like you can actually use, because Dragon's Lair mainly consists of up, down, left, right, and the action button. You use your DVD controller, and you're doing this, you're playing the game. You've also got Dragon's Lair 2, Time Warp, and Space Ace in this collection. So that's pretty cool. I really, really liked this DVD release, and the reason they came out, this is the 20th anniversary special edition, the reason they released this was actually to announce the development of a new game for Dirk the Daring, Dragon's Lair 3D. This one's on the GameCube. I think it also, I know it came out on Xbox and I think PlayStation 2. And I thought, oh yeah, I'm going to get that one as well. This was actually a fairly recent purchase. I saw it in the retro store for cheap and I thought, you know what? I've been hearing them talk about it all the time in this documentary on this DVD collection. Let's pick it up. I do have to say, it's not great. There are sort of two main complaints I have about Dragon's Lair 3D. I don't think it's a limitation of the hardware. The GameCube and the Xbox are pretty powerful machines. I think the PS2 is not as powerful. But they can handle this type of a game, and this game runs a bit slow, or at least it seems sluggish and clunky. Moving Dirk around the different environments, he seems to just like, come on, man, can you run a bit faster or something? And also the environments seem huge compared to, like, you go around the same castle from the cartoon Laserdisc game, and I don't know, I imagined some of those, like, banquet halls or the big maze with the Black Knight in it. In my mind, it's like, okay, the cartoon version of it, the room looks maybe 10 feet across, and then this one, it seems like it's, you know, 50 feet wide, and it takes a long time for this slow-moving Dirk to get through the room. You do the platforming thing where you're on like those shafts that go up and down, you're swinging on ropes, you're doing everything that a platformer has, but I found it very slow, the room's far too large, it didn't feel like, it looks like Dragon's Lair, but it doesn't feel like Dragon's Lair, if that makes sense. So, this is an okay game, if you're a really big Dragon's Lair fan like I am, it's worth trying it out, get it for cheap. It is a platformer, and it's the one I'm going to choose, because I don't know if anybody else is going to choose this one. But I wouldn't say it's a stellar game by any stretch. And the last game that Ben asked about is name a fighting game, like a side-scrolling beat-em-up brawler type of a game. Now, I'm sure a lot of people are choosing the obvious ones, and mine is one of the obvious ones, but with a twist. The very first of those games that I ever played was in 1990, in the arcade, I saw Final Fight. And I loved that machine. I was just like, I am hooked. I went every Friday and I dumped $5 or $6 every Friday into that machine. Loved Final Fight. It's one of the really significant titles for me for nostalgia and kind of importance in at least my early arcade video gaming. I was always kind of upset or annoyed that they never really did a good home version of Final Fight. I mean, the one on the Super NES is missing a character and they edited a whole bunch of stuff and they took out Roxy and Poison. Then they fixed that a bit with the one that came out on the Mega CD, or also known as the Sega CD. But the color scheme is a bit bland or drab. Roxy and Poison are wearing like these biker shorts. It's okay. But then they really improved all of that when they released Final Fight Double Impact on the PlayStation 3. They put everything back the way it was. Roxy and Poison have got their proper outfits. All the alcohol references are back. Everything is exactly arcade quality. And that's good, but all of these titles have one major problem, and that is they're kind of balanced for two players. I mean, the game itself is designed with two of you sitting there on the couch or in front of the arcade cabinet, throwing quarters in there, and you're going across and you're beating up all the bad guys. And if you don't have a buddy to play with, you can't really get very far. At least I couldn't. I kept dying really, really quick. So my choice is Final Fight, but it's actually Final Fight 1 on the Game Boy Advance. And one of the reasons is because it's actually balanced so that one player can get farther in the game. They've got a slightly reduced number of enemies. I think one of the stages is missing, but that's much better than the Super NES. I think it was missing a couple of different stages. So, yes, Final Fight 1 on the Game Boy Advance is much better for playing for a single person, which is my case most of the time. Double Impact on the PS3 is great because it's online multiplayer, so as you're playing, somebody might just hop into your game, like they're joining you in the arcade side by side. The only problem is, Double Impact's about 8 or 9 years old by now, and I don't think anybody plays that anymore. I've hopped in every once in a while, and I'm never joined by anybody, so that's a disadvantage of the way Final Fight Double Impact was designed, and all of the Final Fight games. But not this one. This one's actually got enough balance for one player, you can actually do well. And what's also worth noting, Final Fight 1 for the North American and European release is more like the Super NES one. They took Roxy and Poison out of the game, like they had with the original for the Super NES, and they replaced them with Billy and Sid, which I always thought was ridiculous, but that's a subject for another video I will probably do someday. And so if you're getting Final Fight 1 for Game Boy and you're getting it in North America or in Europe, you're going to get the one that has Billy and Sid, and a lot of the, I think, alcohol references are taken out as well. And when you beat up the car, he doesn't say, oh my God. But this one that I have, and I don't know if this is going to come out on the camera right there, this is the Japanese version. And the Japanese version of Final Fight 1 does have all of that stuff restored. Roxy and Poison are back in their proper outfits. This is the version to get. It's got Japanese text, and you won't really be able to understand what's going on, but except for the fact that it does a game save, so every time you start it up, it asks, do you want to restore your last game? Just say yes, and you're continuing on. And the only other thing, there's some dialogue scenes between the character you are and whatever bad guy, the boss that you're taking on. But you know what? Just look that up online. Check out YouTube. What is he saying? Boom. That's that taken care of. Otherwise, play the Japanese one. If you are a fan of the original Final Fight the way it was originally designed, or like me, if the Roxy Poison thing has a pretty important significance for you, and there will be a video about that someday, then yes, get this one. This is the one to get. Final Fight 1, Japanese release. Okay. There we go. That is my video response to Ben over at TRex Spacestation. Hope you like that, Ben. Yeah, I really like doing these. I like telling little stories about all the different games, and I like the random selection of the way Ben just chooses almost subjects right out of thin air. All right, anyway, so until next time, we'll see you down the rabbit hole.